Well, I felt inclined, no, compelled to record this for future reference. I may put this in with the series Christianity at its Finest, because what we're about to observe is the outrage and anger that I should suggest that one of the great leaders of faith in the scriptures didn't commit a human sacrifice using his own daughter. So David Roper, a friend of mine on Facebook, asked the question, did Jephthah actually offer his daughter as a burnt offering? And I say, scripture records there are two parts to Jephthah's vow. One, who comes out shall belong to the Lord. And two, Jephthah would offer him, her, it up as a burnt offering. It could have been an animal that came out first, in which case Jephthah would be vowed to offer it as appropriate. But what if it were an unclean animal? Could he offer it up as a burnt offering? No. The vow carries with it the implication that if appropriate, he would offer up whatever came out first. A human child is not appropriate for a sacrifice any more than an unclean animal would be. The vow was an and-or and either-or vow. Either whoever comes out of the house first shall belong to you, O Lord, and-or I shall give it up as a burnt offering. We have a clue in the context how Jephthah fulfilled the vow. He gave his daughter to be the Lord's. This means she would never marry and never bear children. She would belong exclusively to the Lord. This is why she asked for 2 months to go out and weep for her virginity. She was going to remain chaste and dedicated to the Lord for the rest of her life. This was a particularly big sacrifice for Jephthah because she was his only child and now his line had ended. The memorial that takes place every year for lamenting Jephthah's daughter is worded ambiguously. It says they lamented before the daughter of Jephthah, which modern translators have erroneously translated about because of their preconceived error that she was sacrificed like an animal. What it should be translated to is lamented to the daughter of Jephthah, meaning every year they went to her and lamented her sacrifice, which clearly indicates she was still alive for the rest of her days, lamenting every year her great sacrifice of never knowing a man or having children. The problem with Christians is that they simply have no Hebrew perspective on Scripture, especially Old Testament. They also bring pagan baggage with them, such as human sacrifice. This is why they turn Christ into a human sacrifice for sins. It's pagan and a godless mindset. Now, this particular individual, there's 46 replies in this. We won't read them all. The vow was to offer her as burnt offering to God. How does it change then? How does it change then become pagan? Or that she worked in the tabernacle of Moses? Judges 11:30-40, and Jephthah vowed a vow unto the Lord. Now he's quoting the scripture, okay. I'm not going to read this whole big long response, but you get the gist. He's very upset that we should suggest that Jephthah, whom Paul named as one of the patriarchs of faith, didn't sacrifice his own daughter in a human sacrifice. Now, they're talking to Brian Lance, whom I have blocked. I can't imagine what he was saying. But my response to this individual, this Bukhani individual, is anyone who has to ask how a human sacrifice is pagan understands nothing. And then he asks, what was the vow? Even though I've already explained this. So as you can see, he's not even reading the thread. You think others don't understand, yet you are blind to what is written. You are the one who understands nothing in this matter because you deny what is written. Then he makes some more comments to Brian Lance, which we'll skip. Then I said, he made a vow of either the first thing person I see shall be yours, or I shall make it a burnt offering. Common sense dictates he is not going to make a burnt offering out of something unclean that first comes out of the house or out of a human being. Then he said something else to Brian Lance, and I said, See my above post. You are not... Oh, he asked Brian Lance, he made a vow to sacrifice what came out to meet him. Is it not written that way? And I said, see my above post. You are applying... You are not applying logic nor context to the vow. Then he skipped... I'm going to skip his comment to Brian Lance. And then he said, your logic and context are not in accordance with what is written, so it's not reliable nor truth. And I said, look, only a true pagan insists that God approves of human sacrifices. Then he made another comment to Brian Lance, and then he answered me, and you believe you are the believer of what is written, yet it is written in those verses I copied and pasted, but you still reject. Who is real pagan between me and you, one who wants to add things according to his logic and context, or he doesn't even know what context means, or one who has believed what is written, judge for yourself the pagan between me and you. You shouldn't be too quick to call people pagans. Then I said, you are taking it all out of context and ignoring important facts, such as God condemns human sacrifice in no uncertain terms. Then he says to both me and Brian Lance, I don't know what it is that you are trying to explain there, really, when it says he performed what he had vowed. Then I posted him a link where the Torah.com, where they explain exactly in detail how these scriptures do not talk about human sacrifice of his daughter. Then he said, Jeffrey Dean, you are seeking to deceive with your explanation. This is the same God who said the children of Israel must only marry children of Israel. And when they had intermarried, they had to put away their wives and children from those marriages. The same God wanted Samson to marry someone who was not an Israelite. He answered Brian Lance a couple of times. Then I answered him, what in the world does intermarrying and putting away wives have to do with this subject? You are deluded. And then this gentleman posted a comment, which includes me. I echo your comments. There is what Brian Lance and Jeffrey Dean hopes the burnt offering sacrifice vow to have been. And there's what the scripture simply says. Actually, no. They hope, for some ungodly reason, they hope that the scripture says that God approves of human sacrifice and that Jephthah actually sacrificed his own daughter. That's their hope. They're the ones clinging to a hope of a burnt sacrifice of a human being. It says the girl was offered for burnt sacrifice just as promised. Which verse changed the burnt sacrifice to mean given to God's service? I don't know. I already explained that, and I even provided a link from someone else who was explaining it. They're not reading the thread, clearly. It's happening a lot. There's what we want the scripture to mean, and there's, no, actually, that is true, but the burnt offering of a human being, that's what they want the scriptures to mean, and that's disturbing to say the least. And there's what it actually says, but our walls won't let us see it for what it is. And then he says, Shalom. Wow. God bless your sister Mercy Basilio. Had hoped they could see it as it is, but they don't. Then he says to me, the intermarriage example was for you to see that anything can be done by God and for God. Really, anything can be done. Now we're getting, you see the danger of Christianity? You see the true raw danger? This is definitely going in the Christianity at its finest series. Anything at all is can be done by God, and for anything can be done for God. You can murder someone for God, and that's fine. That's okay with Bukani Malangu Chikwata. Then he says to me, just because Hebrew scholars agree doesn't make it right. They just disagree with the written truth. No, they carried the written truth for thousands of years before Romans ever got a hold of it, and before the English in the King James era ever got a hold of it. They know what these texts are saying. Believe me, that's one thing they do know. Then Russ Powers says, read the whole chapter. The context of scripture is evident that he sacrificed his daughter. Following the verse cannot be easily dismissed. And then all he does is requote the verse. And it's interesting to find out on Facebook, whenever there's a debate like this that rises up, it's fascinating to me that people think making the same argument over and over again that has already been refuted is going to somehow make the argument true magically, even though it's already been refuted. And they'll quote the same scripture over and over again as if quoting it as many times as you can is going to change what it says or change the proper reading of what it says. Let's look at this thread here. It says, where does it say she was sent away? Says after 2 months she returned to her father and he did to her according to his vow, which was to offer her as a burnt offering. No. That's why she went and wept for her virginity. Well, if she's going to die, what in the world would she care about her virginity? That's the last thing she would be worried about. She's about to be burned. She's about to have her throat slit and be burned. And they think that she went off for 2 months to weep about her virginity? Now, I didn't really respond to that properly. The question would be, where does it say he made a burnt offering of her, sacrificed her? It doesn't say that either. It says he completed the vow. And they're just assuming the vow means he sacrificed her. But it's very ambiguous, and it's just as easy to also take it that he performed the vow in that he gave her to the Lord. It's just a matter of what you want to believe is what it boils down to, because it doesn't actually say that he burned her. They're just reading he performed the vow. Doesn't actually say he made a burnt offering of her. They're just assuming that's what it means by he completed the vow.
There's no reasoning. There's just no reasoning with these people. He said, and look how upset they are that Jephthah never sacrificed his daughter. They're incensed. They so want human sacrifice to be okay. And we'll get to why that is in a minute. He made a vow to give a burnt offering of whatever came out his door first. Turned out to be his daughter. He told her he couldn't go back, and that we all read the scripture, and it seems like he wants to just recap the same pagan concept and reading of that scripture as if that's going to make it more true. That more true than it was in the last thread when I answered it totally. And then I stated to Tony Lair, who responded to me, that his comment to me is gone, but he had responded to me. And I said, only a true pagan would think this. Furthermore, an even worse pagan would get angry when it is pointed out that there is an alternate to his performing in human sacrifice of his daughter, especially since Paul lists him as a man of faith. You should be relieved that this is not what Scripture says. And Anna Drake thumbed that up. Then I said, atheists curse God because of people like you, claiming that God demands human sacrifices. Then Russ Powers jumped in again and said, God said not a single word in this whole story. Nor did God command nor demand Jephthah to make a vow, nor to carry it out. Not even a stone-cold atheist can blame God for this one. We'll look at a video shortly where one of the most popular atheists on YouTube does indeed just what this man says. And the reason you can blame God for this is because God accepts the whatever sacrifice Jephthah made. Okay, we're going to look at that in a minute. He says, and the reason why he was listed as a man of faith is because he made a vow to God and stuck to it without the need for divine provocation. It's not what he did that made him a man of faith. It's how he did it. Now, watch this response that I give to him. He says, but if it makes you feel better to think she was sent off to live out the rest of her life, which is not written at all, then by all means, yes, it is. It's more than implied in there. It's why she was going off to weep for her virginity. It makes no sense that she would be weeping for her virginity for 2 months if she's going to die. That makes no sense at all. That's completely illogical. Then he says, then by all means, whatever floats your goats. But to call people pagans for believing the context of Scripture, accepting the good, the bad, and the ugly, not letting any of it waver their faith, well, that's not cool, brah. And then he says, if Judges 11 bothers y'all, I recommend not even reading Judges 19. And then he quotes it. This is misdirection. We're not even going to go into that. It's an improper comparison, and it's total misdirection. Then Tony Lair says, you are so easily offended. Learn from Russ and the others. Don't be so hard-headed. I'm the one that's hard-headed. That's funny. Then I said to Russ Powers, Paul lists Jephthah as a man of faith, which would be a tacit approval of human sacrifice. Man, you people don't know Scripture. Then I said, I'm not hard-headed. I just know how to read. ROFL, which is more than I can say for the rest of this bunch. And then he said, ouch, Jeffrey. Well, I'm just speaking the truth here. I'm not insulting anyone. And then I said, look, Tony, I even provided them with a link to one Hebrew Torah site. There are many, which explain why this is not a tale of human sacrifice. There are many others that can be found with a simple Google search. They are like the liberals. They live in an echo chamber, a bubble in which they only listen to people who echo what they were taught by their pastors, priests, whatever you want to call their leader. They only repeat regurgitated ideas from long-dead white men who didn't have a single ounce of spiritual understanding. It is sad, really, but I'm not offended. I just tell it like it is. Then I said, you said the following, and the reason why he was listed as a man of faith is because he made a vow to God and stuck to it without the need for divine provocation. It's not what he did that made him a man of faith, it's how he did it. I submit to everyone here and to future generations, this is the main problem with the Christian religion. They believe that a murderer can be a man of faith as long as his murder was in furtherance of his misguided idea of what it means to serve God. This is why the Christian religious history is replete with burning people alive, torture, strangulation, mutilation, and killing with the sword. They simply don't know what faith means. And then Chalet Lou said, you can read it. It's written plain as day. And then they quote the scripture again. See what I mean? As if quoting the scripture over and over again or repeating the same argument over and over again somehow makes it true. He made a vow to God, blah, blah, blah. He's making the same argument. All he had to really do was say, I agree with everything that these other people said and I disagree with your reading. But it's interesting. He quotes a scripture in Deuteronomy. When thou shalt vow a vow unto the Lord thy God, thou shalt not slack to pay it. For the Lord thy God will surely require it of thee. So they're admitting that God required Jephthah to sacrifice his daughter. How is God not to be blamed for this if this is what God required? And then he quotes a whole bunch of scriptures along that same line. They completely destroy their own arguments. They're saying God's not to be blamed for the human sacrifice of Jephthah's daughter. However, then they make arguments that really demonstrate and show that, yes, indeed, God is to be blamed. Then Russ Powers made this big, long post that I'm not going to read. Sorry. It's just not worth my time or yours. I'm just going to read my responses to stuff like this. He says, according to your logic, you might as well cross the following killers off your list. And he starts naming repentant killers. People that kill... No, he starts naming killers who were killing in defense of the nation or in wartime. And some repentant killers are thrown in there. But he throws them all in one lump. Killing... This comes from the King James... mistranslation of the commandment, thou shalt not kill, They get confused and they think that killing is a sin. Any kind of killing, even if you're in defense. But what that commandment really says is thou shalt not murder. So he's lumping everybody up who's ever killed with the murderers in the Bible, which there are murderers in the Bible who repented. So here's my response. Ridiculous. You are comparing acts of war and rescuing captive relatives from hostile forces with the brutal human sacrifice of an innocent child. You are devoid of all morality. You, like most Christians, are amoral. And then he says to Brian Lance, that's what the text says, but it's not talking about human sacrifice? Really? So the scripture doesn't mean what it says? I've heard that a lot. And then I said, no, it's not talking about human sacrifice. He said that the first person or thing that came out would either belong to the Lord or be a burnt offering. We know that his vow of making a burnt offering didn't apply to unclean animals, for God would not accept a burnt offering of an unclean animal. We know his vow of making a burnt offering didn't apply to humans because God would condemn you for an human sacrifice. Then he answers my devoid of all morality charge and says, sorry, I don't force God into a box. Simeon, Levi, Moses, Elijah, Samson, Samuel, and Paul did not kill in war. Well, see, because I didn't mention the murderers that he threw in there with the people that killed in war, he's going to focus on that like I'm making an invalid point. When it is him making a comparison, Elijah, Samson, Samuel, and Paul to all the other people who killed in war. So he doesn't even get the point. It is impossible to reason with these people. I don't even know why I feel sometimes compelled or, you know, I feel sometimes inclined to try. You never know who you're going to reach, but really these people are hopeless. Okay, Levi and Simeon killed a man in a whole city because they felt their sister's virtue was tarnished. Samuel killed a man because Saul spared his life. Elijah killed the prophets of Baal. So I'm going to skip the rest of what he said there. Then I'm going to skip this comment. He said, I see no or there. And then I said, Paul repented of his sin of murder. You don't see an apostle later extol him as a great man of faith because he martyred Stephen. All of the murders you point to were murderers that God condemned, for which the people were punished, and for which they all repented and were forgiven. In your Jephthah scenario, God honors the murder, he never repents of it, and then thousands of years later, an apostle mentions the murder and says, what a great man of faith, because he did it. You are crazy. Let's reflect on how incensed these people are that someone might suggest that Jephthah didn't commit human sacrifice in the Bible. They really, truly want that scripture to be about human sacrifice. If that isn't the most disturbing thing that we've encountered from Christians on Facebook since I started making these videos about Christianity at its finest, this, to me, this thread that I've been reading is the most disturbing of them all. And then he quotes the same scripture again, only uses a different translation, I think, this time. Yeah, he's using a bunch of translations, and he's not getting the point. And since there's two parts, and one could apply to humans and one might not apply to humans, it has to be or. I said, yes, see the two parts I will give you, and I will sacrifice it. Pure common sense says if an unclean animal came out of the house, he wouldn't sacrifice an unclean animal to God and offend God. There's common sense here, but it's becoming obvious you don't have any. Then he quotes the same scripture again. Then this individual tells me, but you're missing it. God didn't accept it because, of course, it's unclean. But that doesn't mean that God did absolutely accept it. He was called a great man of faith for performing this particular sacrifice. So absolutely, God accepted Jephthah's sacrifice. Was Jephthah punished for murdering his daughter in the scripture? God accepted the sacrifice. Jephthah was never punished. He was never rebuked, okay? So I'm not going to read the rest of it. And then I stated, a vow to God cannot be kept if God doesn't accept it. This is where you really show your ignorance. And then he says, also, you have to consider something. If Jephthah's daughter was an unacceptable offering, then why do we accept Jesus as an acceptable offering? Bam. There we go. This is why they're so upset. Because they preach human sacrifice. They can deny, the Christian can deny all they want. They'll come into my YouTube videos and post comments that I'm putting words in their mouth. And they'll say they do not preach human sacrifice and that Jesus was God, and therefore he was not a human sacrifice. They'll make all of these arguments if you've been into any of my videos. So there we have it right here. The evidence that needs to be recorded for all posterity. Christians preach human sacrifice. This is why they're so upset about my saying that Jephthah did not sacrifice his daughter. Let's read this post again. This needs to go down in history, I'm telling you, because this shows you the mindset of the Christian. They believe and they love human sacrifice. Also, you have to consider something, he says. If Jephthah's daughter was an unacceptable offering, then why do we accept Jesus as an acceptable offering? If human sacrifice is such an abomination to God, why would he himself give his only son as an offering? Which he never did. Now, I think I stopped responding to this individual at this point because he's completely and totally apostate. And this proves it. And this guy starts to try and argue once again that somehow in his convoluted logic, the fact that God accepted the vow, that God gave him victory over the Ammonites, right? This proves that God didn't accept the vow somehow. I don't know. I'm not even reading it anymore. They're just totally illogical. I'm going to skip this. And now he's dropping the microphone like he made some great point. That I really love that. Okay. And then he goes and starts quoting the same scriptures again. He says he's done with the conversation. And then I said, once again, a Christian ignores contexts, ignores all the law and the traditions found in scripture to make a single verse justify human sacrifice. Crazy, but true. Then I said to this Chalelu, exactly my point. God had to have accepted the so-called human sacrifice or the vow would not have been completed. Thus, it was not a human sacrifice he vowed. It was an animal sacrifice, if appropriate, or to give to the Lord, whoever or whatever came out first. And then he's like, he's arguing the burnt sacrifice argument again. He doesn't change anything. He doesn't add anything to his argument. He just makes the same exact, at least when I make the same argument over and over again, I respond to the last post and I respond to their points that they made in the last points. He completely ignores the points I make. And then he does it again here. I quit talking to this individual too. Now he's quoting a scripture again. Then I reposted this thing from thetorah.com. A lot of people echoing that Jephthah killed his daughter. They're all coming in here. I bet you if this thread were to continue long enough, we would get hundreds of people coming in here insisting that human sacrifice is perfectly okay with God. And they use Jephthah as an example. And then this person says, yes, as promised, only one example of human sacrifice by Jews. And then I said, there has never been an human sacrifice by Jews that God sanctioned. And he thumbed that up. He knows what I'm getting at there. Somebody comes in, some poor soul comes in and wants to try and reason with them, makes the exact same argument I just made. The vow contains two parts, and he's absolutely correct. You can see it clearly. Then I said to him, I already explained this all to them. They got very angry that Jephthah, one of the great patriarchs of faith, didn't commit a human sacrifice using his own daughter. We can safely assume that Christianity is now utterly apostate. Then he quotes Titus 1:15, unto the pure all things are pure, but unto them that are defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure, but even their mind and conscience is defiled.
And my final word in this thread was this. Some of the people here merely refuse to learn. Several arguments were made here regarding this text by numerous people, which demonstrate how hard it is for them to let go of their presupposed teachings of men. 1. They argue that it says Jephthah completed the vow, and therefore this means he made a burnt offering of his daughter. This is actually circular logic. Jephthah vowed to make a burnt offering of his daughter, therefore the fact it says he completed the vow is proof that the vow was a burnt offering. Does anyone else see the flaw in this logic? The statement, he completed the vow, could only prove that he made a burnt offering of her if you prove the assumption that his vow was to make a burnt offering of her. Since your opposition is maintaining that he never vowed to sacrifice a human when he made this vow, you are forced to prove your position. When it says he completed the vow, it could very well simply mean that he gave her to the Lord. What supports this assumption is simple. She wept for her virginity for 2 months before the vow was satisfied. If she's going to die, it makes no logical sense that she's weeping over her virginity. Who says, wait, I need to go mourn for my virginity when they are told they are about to be murdered? Who? It's almost comical that they don't see how ludicrous this is. The second thing that demonstrates that his vow was completed not by her murder, but by her remaining chaste, is the statement, and she knew no man. Judges 11:39. And it came to pass at the end of 2 months that she returned unto her father, who did with her according to his vow, which he had vowed, and she knew no man. Notice there is a colon. So this finishes that. Notice there is a colon between vowed and she knew no man. This tells you that which he vowed was for her to know no man. A colon introduces an element or series of elements that illustrates or amplifies the information that preceded the colon. And she knew no man amplifies the information that preceded it, which was who did with her according to his vow, which he had vowed. The vow is clearly that she would know no man ever. According to his vow, which he had vowed, and she knew no man. With a colon separated in between. They're connected. This is how the vow was completed. She knew no man. And it was a custom in Israel, and it goes on. This is clearly telling you that the vow was for her to know no man. Otherwise, the statement is completely out of place. What would it matter if she knew no man when he's making of her a human sacrifice? You have to think about all of the Hollywood movies about the Aboriginal tribes who sacrifice virgins to volcano gods. Apparently, they think that virginity is a requirement of human sacrifice in Israel. This is a blatant implication that human sacrifice was so common that there's even a tradition that it must be a virgin that is sacrificed. There's no such traditions in Israel. There's no provision for sacrificing virgins to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. In light of this, we see how truly ignorant is their reading of this text. Okay, this is a video about Jephthah made by a pretty popular atheist, 43 Alley. It's 142,000 views.
We start with a man named Jephthah, the son of a prostitute. His father takes him in, but his siblings, ashamed of who he is, they run him off. He is a great warrior, and he leaves in disgust at those who wronged him. Eventually, Israel is invaded, and the judges of Israel decide that they need Jephthah.
The Holy Bible. The King James Version, the Book of Judges, chapter 11. Now Jephthah the Gileadite was a mighty man of valor, and it came to pass in process of time that the children of Ammon made war against Israel. And it was so that when the children of Ammon made war against Israel, the elders of Gilead went to fetch Jephthah out of the land of Tob. And they said unto Jephthah, Come and be our captain, that we may fight with the children of Ammon. Then Jephthah went with the elders of Gilead, and the people made him head and captain over them. Then the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jephthah, and Jephthah vowed a vow unto the Lord, and said, If thou shalt without fail deliver the children of Ammon into mine hands, then it shall be that whatsoever cometh forth of the doors of my house to meet me when I return in peace from the children of Ammon shall surely be the Lord's, and I will offer it up for a burnt offering. So Jephthah passed over unto the children of Ammon to fight against them, and the Lord delivered him into his hands, and he smote them with a very great slaughter. Thus the children of Ammon were subdued before the children of Israel. And Jephthah came to Mizpeh unto his house, and behold, his daughter came out to meet him with timbrels and with dances. And she was his only child. Beside her he had neither son nor daughter. And it came to pass, when he saw her, that he rent his clothes and said, Alas, my daughter, thou hast brought me very low, and thou art one of them that trouble me. For I have opened my mouth unto the Lord, and I cannot go back. And she said unto him, My father, if thou hast opened thy mouth unto the Lord, do to me according to that which hath proceeded out of thy mouth. And she said unto her father, Let this thing be done for me. Let me alone 2 months, that I may go up and down upon the mountains, and bewail my virginity, I and my fellows. And he said, Go.
As we've already said, it simply makes no sense that she's going to weep for her virginity for 2 months if she's about to die.
And he sent her away for 2 months, and she went with her companions, and bewailed her virginity upon the mountains.
We have to first ask just what Jephthah was thinking when he made that vow. Was he expecting a dog or some chickens to greet him when he got home?
The use of the term it instead of who in the vow indicates that indeed he was expecting a goat or a lamb or some other animal. Also, his reaction when his daughter came out indicates she was not supposed to be there.
Nevertheless, Jephthah feels absolutely bound to give his daughter to the flames. As with the other two attempted sacrifices to Yahweh, God or other people save the day. It's important to note that both are present here. God evidently answered the prayer and helped Israel defeat the invading army of Ammon. Thus, he's actively cognizant as a character. On the other hand, the daughter has all these friends with whom she gets to hang out with for 2 months. Surely they can pass word on to try to save this girl. And Jephthah has nearly 60 days to think this through. God obviously listens to Jephthah's prayers. I'm sure they can mediate this thing in 2 months, swap out a rooster or a bull or something.
And it came to pass at the end of 2 months that she returned unto her father, who did with her according to his vow which he had vowed, and she knew no man. And it was custom in Israel that the daughters of Israel went yearly to lament the daughter of Jephthah the Gileadite 4 days in a year.
Who did with her according to his vow which he had vowed, and she knew no man.